So we've got the distinct pleasure of being in the... I'd say it's a mansion. Would you class it as a mansion of Kerry K's?
It's more, a little bit bigger than Terry Stiles.
We've had a great session with you there, sort of working with Savannah and Huey, but we're just switching tack a little bit here, because what a lot of people outside of boxing perhaps don't know is you work corners pretty much every weekend. Every time I see a show, you work in a corner, you work some amazing fights, and you've had the best seat in the house. And there's a few that have sort of sprung to my mind, and I remember the first ever interview I did in boxing was with you, and you talked about you were going to corner a Bellew fight coming up. But Bellew David Hay, I know you've had a lot with Tony Bellew, but Bellew Hay, that was a really huge fight, a turning point in heavyweight boxing as well, because it, you know, everyone expected Tony to get knocked out, really, even if you were a big Tony fan. What was it like?
It was incredible. It was incredible. And as you said, the best seat in the house. And you could argue that at that particular fight, Dave Caldwell had probably 6 inches better seat than I had, but Dave Caldwell couldn't enjoy it as much as I did, because there was no pressure on me. All the pressure was on Dave Caldwell. Yeah. So I had the second best seat in the house, but enjoyed it, because there's nothing I could do but enjoy the fight. And a lot of people should realise, and I think they will, but a massive fight is not just about that 1 hour. A massive fight is the week before, the build up, you know it, the press conferences, the weigh in, the way the media do it and everything. So I've had some fantastic nights with Tony Bellew. You got to remember that Tony used to come to our gym when he was an amateur, because he's a good friend of the Smiths, obviously. And Paul Smith used to travel to Denton to Better Bodies and Billy Graham's Phoenix gym. And Paul Smith trained with Billy, and I used to do strength work with Paul. For his very, very first fight, Paul Smith. I apologise, sorry.
That's all right.
How was that? Make the cut.
There you go.
Make the cut. The greatest cut man on the planet.
I see what he's got to say.
Mick, I'm just doing an interview for British boxers. Oh, he's
had enough.
No, he switched off before. Let me put that on silent. Mick the cuts. Mick Williamson.
Legend of cuts, yeah.
Well, like, yeah. I he didn't teach me in the respect of this is what you do, Kerry.
Yeah.
But I was in the corner for 50 or more fights with Mick the Cuts, Paul Smith,
yeah,
Macklin, Gomez, Arnie Farnell, Ricky Hatton, Matthew Hatton.
Yeah.
And so I'm in the corner and I watched.
And all of those lads you just mentioned did cut up, actually.
Oh,
all of them.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. Gomez, Ricky, yeah. Famously, Ricky famously. Yeah. So I just watched Mick the Cuts, and then one day, he didn't, for whatever reason, Mick wasn't there. I did say it was in a previous interview, I did say it was at Old Trafford, but I've since found out it was in Liverpool, and it was Liam Smith doing a 4 or a 6 rounder. Joe Gallagher didn't have anyone to help him, so I helped him, and Liam got cut.
Cool, yeah.
So that's how I started doing cuts.
Well, talking of cuts, because it really is an art to it. Talking of cuts, I remember you cornering Huey when he fought in Bulgaria.
Yeah.
And I put the fight on my honeymoon. I said to the wife, you've got to watch this fight. And as soon as I saw the cut, I said to her, oh, don't worry, fight's over. It's not going to go 4 completed rounds, it's over. But remarkably, the work you did on the cut actually led to Huey lasting the distance. Firstly, that was a really jagged sort of cut. When he came back to the corner, it started in the first round, but opened up big in the second round. What's your reaction when you see a cut that's that jagged and deep?
Well, your work's cut out, but you haven't really got time to mentally assess what you do. You just go into autopilot, don't you? Do what you do. You know it's bad, because Peter straight away said to me, do you want to get in the ring, Kerry? You know, knowing that instead of me leaning over trying to do a cut and somebody's giving him water and so on, Peter went getting Kerry. So you know it's bad. But and then, you know, when they go seconds away, round 3, the round, you're thinking, you're not looking at the punches, you look at the blood, any blood, any blood, any blood. Yeah. And as the fight continues and you've stopped the blood, you get more and more confident, I guess. And And yeah, you know, you to be honest, I'm being big-headed now. A great feeling of pride. You know, a great feeling of pride.
But how did you stem the flow? I mean, what is the actual process? The technical process.
Well, if you put adrenaline on too early, the blood will push the adrenaline out.
I see.
So it's not going to do. And if you get cut doing some do-it-yourself around your house, what's the first thing you do? You compress it. Mm. You compress it, don't you? So you compress it. And maybe, bear in mind, you've only got 50 seconds.
Yeah.
So you compress it, and then after maybe 3 to 5 seconds, you then swap the compression with adrenaline, and then put the compression back over it. And you're normally doing that with your left hand. But then don't forget, he's probably got blood all over his body, and you don't want the referee or the doctors to see him full of blood. So with your right hand, you're cleaning him up. You're cleaning him up while you're keeping the compression and the adrenaline on. And then you hear seconds away, and then you go sit down, stay down, you take it away, and you're vacillating. So it's about coordination.
Timing.
And also letting the referee and the doctor see that you're totally in command of the court. Letting them see that you're not flapping. Because if you're flapping, they'll say, well, it's not going to get fixed, stop the fight. So if they can see a confident cut man.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's interesting.
I remember Billy Graham, as we all know, Ricky used to cut. And a lot of your viewers might or might not know this, but a referee on a championship fight will visit each dressing room. So with one of the officials, either the British Board of Boxing official or the IBF official or whoever. So the referee will always come into the dressing room. So the referee would come in the dressing room, and Billy Graham, so the referee would say, I want a clean fight. When I say break, don't break, go through some basic rules. And then the referee will say, is there anything you want to say to me? And some people will go, well, watch his guard and watch this and the other. Yeah. But Billy Graham used to always say, look, my fighter cuts. I'm telling you up front, my fighter cuts. But I've got the best cuts man in the business, Mick Williamson. Please give my cut man time to work on the cut. Mm. And so the referee leaves the dressing room going, that's a confident corner. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? And so
it's very interesting that you say these things, because it shows you that there's more elements to having a good team around you. They do things that are subtle, and the corner isn't, you know, the corner has to work in unison as a unit.
Absolutely, absolutely. And everybody's got to know their place in the corner. Mm. You know what I mean? And I think one of the most important things in a corner is there should be one voice, the trainer. There's not, you know, yeah, sometimes I see it on television where you've got 3 or 4 people barking instructions. How can that possibly be any good for a boxer that's basically just trying to get his breath? He might be hurt. Mm. His confidence might want building up, and you've got 4 or 5 people barking instructions at him. Yeah. So one voice in the corner, always one voice.
Another fighter, I actually was at this one, and I saw you there, and I thought, wow, imagine being in a corner for a fight like this. And it turned out to be an epic. It was a recent fight. It was Carl Frampton versus Josh Warrington. It turned out to, I mean, the first couple of rounds, I was mesmerised by the raw intensity, the game plan of Warrington, the ability of Carl Frampton to stay and punch and trade with Josh Warrington. But that was a great battle in Manchester. What were your experiences of that particular corner as well?
Well, one of the biggest things that I'll always remember about that corner was Jamie Moore in about 8, 9, 10, when both fighters were suffering. Yes. Let's live in the real world. Both fighters were suffering. And Jamie Moore said to Carl Frampton, I'm not asking you to do anything I've not done myself. And I thought, wow. And then it led me back to think, does a good trainer need to have been a boxer?
Interesting. Yeah.
Right? And that statement kind of made, I'm not saying a trainer has to have been a boxer, but if you've not been a boxer, you could never say words like that.
True. And he'd been there before with Macklin in particular, but those other ones as well.
I was in the corner. Jones. I was in the corner with Macklin on that fight.
Yeah.
So what a weird situation.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
What a weird situation. So the fight that he was referring to, I'm not asking you to do anything that I've not done. I was in Macklin's corner.
that is still my number one favourite British dust up of all time.
Now you mentioned Jamie Moore is a good mate of yours, but he was in Macklin's Corner. What are your memories of that fight, being watching it from so close?
Jamie Moore came to my gym about 6 weeks before the fight to buy some supplements, and I was in the gym. Jamie come in, I goes over to Jamie, hi Jamie, la la la, chatting away, and I've just come buy some supplements, Kerry. And I looked at him and I went, Jamie, I'm in Macklin's Corner, you know what I mean? And Jamie went, Kerry, Macklin trains here, it's business, don't be daft. And he couldn't have been more, Kerry, of course you're in Macklin's Corner, Billy Graham's in Macklin's Corner, you know, Oliver's in my corner. You know, he said, yeah, Kerry, don't worry about it. And I thought, wow, Jamie, you know what I mean? You know, another thing about that fight, I don't know a lot of your people won't know. That was a horrific fight. We all saw it. And Jamie knocked Macklin out. And immediately, nobody had to tell Jamie. Jamie didn't start celebrating. Yeah. And all the crowd started celebrating. And Jamie Moore looked at all the Salford crowd and went,
yeah.
And he controlled the crowd. Then Jamie, instead of going to an after fight party that had been arranged, cancelled it, and Jamie went to hospital to see how Macklin was.
That says a lot about the man. That really does.
Doesn't it?
Yeah.
Think about that.
Did you think it would be such a ferocious fight beforehand? I mean, you were working close with Macklin, wasn't you? And obviously,
Macklin trained at the gym.
Yeah,
Macklin trained at Billy Graham's gym.
Phoenix, yeah.
And Macklin was a beast of us. Macklin was a very, very strong athlete. Very, very strong athlete. But so was Jamie. You know, I think Jamie and Macklin. I always say Macklin was the young bull and Jamie was the old bull. But, you know, Jamie knew how to control the pace, I think.
What a fight to be involved in. You've been in a lot of fights, and obviously Ricky Atten's career. But if there is a moment or a fight that stands out for you, you know, which is maybe the most exciting or most memorable, what was it? What occasion?
Well, the biggest occasion would have to be one that ended on a negative, which was the Mayweather and Hatton fight.
Mm.
You know what I mean? That was ridiculous, wasn't it?
Mm.
30,000+ Brits flying to Vegas, flying around in a Learjet. You know, don't forget, I'm from a council house estate in Gorton, you know what I mean? Flying around in a Learjet.
That's the old occasion of that.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, that was ridiculous.
Well, Ricky cut in that fight, actually, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
And probably, from a positive point of view, again, Ricky Atten, Costa Zoo. It'd have to be Costa Zoo, wouldn't it? You know what I mean? It'd have to be Costa Zoo. 2 o'clock in the morning, and it was a complete sellout at the MEN at the time. It was called the MEN, and you couldn't get a ticket.
What atmosphere.
Yeah.
And then we ended up in some hotel bar. I don't think we started to have a drink till 5 in the morning. And, you know, as you can imagine, it got better.
you've cornered against, in the opposite corner, to AJ a couple of times.
AJ
as well.
Twice. Matt Skelton. And Dillian White. I was doing cuts for Dillian, I mean, probably from a atmosphere that was pretty special. And you know, I watched it on telly the other week. I was just flicking through television the other week, boxing, and it came on, and I didn't realise, but AJ walked first.
Yeah,
so it was obviously
to the Stormzy, I think it was.
Yeah, but it wasn't even, obviously it wasn't for anything.
The press conference before that,
yeah.
He just said go on, let him walk first. They were arguing about it, and he said go on, let Dillian walk first then.
No, Dillian walked second.
I was
in the corner with Dillian.
Yeah.
And then I'm watching, so it just shows you that you miss some details.
Yeah.
You know,
in the moment,
do you understand what I mean?
Talking of moment, there was a moment in that fight where it nearly escalated into a bit of a melee
shocking,
in the ring.
Yeah, shocking.
And I mean, are you thinking this fight's going to end in disqualification?
Well,
are you trying to hold people back?
No, they all jumped in, Dillian's team, as you know, and I just thought, and I'm doing cuts, remember, and I thought, I'm not jumping in, you know what I mean? I'm 60, I'm probably about 65, and I just got trampled in it, you know what I mean? And Dillian's trainer, Jonathan Banks,
yeah.
superb. Yeah. Did you see? You ever,
I used to watch him fight. Yeah.
But see the way he handled it.
Yeah, he grabbed him.
He just went like that and done his job. It was superb the way Jonathan Banks took control. Took control and interviews. And you know, let's live in the real world. If the referee had been, I can't remember the referee to be honest. But if the referee wanted to, he could have disqualified Dillian. You know.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
He had grounds to disqualify Dillian, the referee.
Well, yeah, because the team seconds came in the ring and that technically could be a disqualification.
Although, could he? Because it was the crowd, really, even though it was Dillian's mates.
Well,
it was debatable.
One where Carl Froch was knocking out Boutte and Eddie Hearn got in the ring. And then afterwards, the referee had commented that anyone that comes in the ring that's not authorised to be in the ring could result in a disqualification.
Well, look at Stephen Smith's dad.
Yeah,
Darkie Smith.
Yeah,
but he was the trainer. He was the trainer. But I don't know the referee. But the referee showed common sense. That's the best way to put it. The referee showed common sense.
It was just heating up. Can you imagine if he called it off then?
Oh, that's what I mean. The referee showed common sense, which is nice, which is good. Let's live in the real world. That's the sign of a good referee.
Are there any corners coming up that you're looking forward to, or even ones that perhaps you?
I always enjoy Sam Eggington.
Yeah.
I always enjoy Sam Eggington, and I love Sam Eggington, and I'm going out to Florence on the 20th of next month, which is a Thursday night.
Right,
that's a one-off, isn't it?
Yeah.
Thursday night.
Yeah.
So I'm going out to Florence with Sam, and obviously I'm looking forward to. Yeah, well, he's just done a couple of non-television fights.
Yeah, VIP show he was on the last.
Yeah, and a villa show.
Yeah,
which I went down and worked. Obviously Yui Fiori and Savannah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yui's got a big one coming up. Just before we get onto that one though, were you in the corner when Sam had that upset loss against the African?
When he put his hands down and took some blows. But you know, I don't know, Sam had an operation on his eye a few weeks earlier, and the surgeon was there. This is according to John Pegg. So, John, if I'm saying things out of order, I apologise. But John Pegg said the surgeon went, there are certain people that have had a general anaesthetic that it can last for a long time.
Right.
And the surgeon wondered whether or not he was not clear, you know what I mean?
Mm. Well, he's got his shot again. He's got a European title shot coming up, as you mentioned. You mentioned Yui there. Big fight with Alexander Povetkin.
Yeah.
You're doing not just your role as a cutsman and doing that in the corner, as you mentioned, but you know, you've been doing some fantastic strength work with him, and how do you like his chances going into it, and how do you assess that fight?
Well, I think boxing's about timing, isn't it? And this is a very good Yui Fiori, and for Povetkin's 39
now,
so you know what I mean, and I think Yui's style is very effective, isn't it? You know what I mean? So and Peter's not daft. And I don't believe for 1 minute Peter had put him in with Povetkin if he didn't fancy his chances. Mm. You know what I mean? And as Eddie Hearn says, you've got to respect Yui's balls, haven't you?
Yeah.
I mean if Mike Tyson,
big set of balls.
How do you know, Eddie? But if Mike Tyson was still at his prime, you would say, I'll fight him. You know, know what I mean?
Yeah,
I've noticed that about you in the gym. You came today, which is the end of the week. You find that Yui at the beginning of the week is more raring to go. But whatever you say to Yui, he'll do one more rep. Mm-hmm. Whatever you say to Yui, he'll want to do more. And one of the biggest tasks in strength training, not cardiovascular training, is say to Yui, we've done. Mm-hmm. That's enough. You know what I mean? Because he always wants to do more.
Yeah. And Savannah's recently announced she's now on the Matchroom platform.
Yeah.
A bit of a new venture for you working with female boxers. Just because it's, coincidental, I suppose. But you've talked about...
Well, I've inherited Savannah.
Yeah, you've inherited Savannah, haven't you? Yeah.
Because Peter came here, actually, with Maureen, Peter's wife, after the fight in Bulgaria. And they'd obviously assessed you and felt that he needed a little bit more strength.
Yeah.
So I'm not using the word power because I believe power is from the boxing trainer, angles, leverages, that's how you generate power. But if your athlete's a little bit stronger, then obviously with the right angles, you can generate more strength. So he said, I'd like you to do a bit of strength work with Yui, which I agreed to. And but then Savannah arrived, so you know what I mean. And then recently Sean Turner's arrived.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And Savannah's asked me that Chantel Cameron wants to do a bit as well, so I don't know, it's growing arms.
You're never
going to
get that
it's
weekend
out,
off now, are you?
It's growing arms and legs. You know what I mean?
But you've mentioned that she's really strong, though.
I listen, I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoy Yui and Savannah's company.
Yeah.
I really do enjoy the company, you know what I mean?
Mm.
And they're good to work with.
And at your stage of your career now, where you're very, very well known on the circuit and you've worked with them, you can be selective, can't you? So the people that you're working with, you know, it's because you actually want to be involved with them, isn't it?
Well, I don't charge them any money, so obviously there's no other reason.
Yeah.
I'm doing it for free. I'm doing it for free because it's a hobby. Yeah. Do you understand what I mean? Because
yeah.
I enjoy the company. But
yeah.
So if I don't like them, why would I?
Yeah.
If I don't enjoy the company, why would I possibly work with them?
Yeah.
You know
and it's
I mean?
It's interesting, that, and it's nice to hear that in a industry where you obviously always hear the phrase boxing's a business, boxing's a business.
I know, but I'm in a lovely position now, and I'm 69. I've done very well in life. I'm not skinned, you know what I mean? So why would I try and take a few quid off someone who's not earning any money anyhow? Listen, if Klitschko asked me to work with him,
mm.
I'd say, yeah, how much?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I mean? Why not? But you know what I mean? Why would I possibly take money off somebody? Not I'm not talking about it. And sometimes I get asked to do like four round corners, and
yeah.
I'll go down there. I to do how much you're okay. Don't worry about it. Well, why would I? You know what I mean? When they skin anyhow.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, if I was skinned, I'd have to. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good point. But you know, as I say, we always bump into each other at these shows, and it looks like you're thoroughly enjoying. You've still got a hell of a lot of passion for the game. You're still doing a lot of your nutrition seminars as well, though, aren't you? And your bodybuilding
I'm
seminars.
I'm doing less and less. I'm doing less and less. And the reason I'm doing less and less, I think Google.
Right,
Google's there for everyone, isn't there?
Yeah.
There's loads of YouTube information now, loads and loads and loads. Whether that information is accurate or not, that's irrelevant, but there are people that don't really, you know, you can Google anything this day and age, don't you? So I've noticed I'm doing less and less seminars, which suits me. I'm 69.
Mm.
You know what I mean? I'm 69. How much, you know. But, you know, I still do the odd one. I did one about 3 weeks ago. I did one for the board. I did one for the board in Motherwell the other week, on a trainer's course.
Yeah.
Yeah, trainer's course. Yeah. Darren Barker was on it.
I've seen the picture.
Made me laugh. I'm doing a bit of a talk. There's Darren Barker sat in the audience. You know what I mean? I sent him out. He passed.
Yeah. Well, that's another one. When he beat Gail for the world title.
Absolutely.
What a
lovely man, Darren
yeah.
Barker.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he's just a
yeah.
lovely, lovely. Can you imagine if you had a daughter and she brought him home? You'd be
you'd,
well.
Yeah,
happy.
You'd be all right with that.
You'd be well happy.
Anyone else? No chance. But you'd be all right with that.
You'd be well happy, wouldn't you? You
yeah.
know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it made me laugh because he sat on the course. You know what I mean?
That's it,
all right, my love.
Well, it's been, you know, thanks for letting me and Chris sort of tag along with you today, and it's been really interesting just getting your insights on all the stuff you do and continue to do in the game. And Chris, is there anything else I've missed out? And
no, don't think so. Thanks for the break, Kenneth, today. It's been
yeah.
good to us. I mean, your first love was boxing, wasn't it?
I used to train at Colliers.
Was Brian the
yeah,
coach?
Brian, he didn't take any notice of me because I was just one of them kids who walked in and paid probably 50p at the time
yeah.
and just punched the bag all
night.
It's
gone up, it's 3 quid now.
You know what I mean? Yeah, I used to train at Colliers.
It was boxing at the heart of the club.
Oh, God.
What year were we talking?
40 years ago.
Yeah,
40 years ago.
Yeah,
very
well.
Yeah.
And then you got into the bodybuilding. And
yeah, well, I originally was a karate. But I first started out bodybuilding when I was 14 because I worked on a building site and there was a couple of bodybuilders who were electricians and I was in awe of them. I don't know. And then I involved to running marathons and then karate. And then I did one of the first full contact fights. And the boxer
yeah.
beat me up, to be honest, so it taught
yeah,
me that
nice
gloves
me, yeah.
were
yeah.
More important, do you understand what I mean? So that's when I started training at Colliers.
Well, I think you've got some guests coming
yeah.
in now,
I've
so
got,
we'll,
yeah,
we'll,
I've got some lumps, I've got some lumps coming.
Yeah, your arm's as big as my leg, by the way. So yeah, thanks very much for that. Really appreciate it. It's always good to see you, and see you again soon.
Sorted.
Cheers.
Better.